This special program, an interview between H.R. Bockage, NBC's Washington commentator, and Faik Konitsa, His Excellency the Minister to the United States from Albania, has come to you from our Washington studios. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
And now I'm going to ask him the question that I asked him this afternoon in the hotel apartment, in the midst of his library of 1,000 books, which is Albania in America. Mr. Minister, do you consider yourself to be the envoy extraordinary and minister plenipotentiary of the Kingdom of Albania still, as they say in diplomatic language?
I most certainly do, Mr. Bockage. No other government exists in Albania. A government cannot exist unless it has the backing of the people who are governed. No matter what form of government the Italians pretend to set up, it will not have popular backing. I still represent my king and my country.
But the dispatches say that King Zog has left Albania.
That's very likely a matter of strategy. He will go back and lead his people in due time. Meanwhile, he naturally wants to be with his sick wife and four-day-old baby.
But what will you represent? Your government has ceased to exist, hasn't it?
It has ceased to be seen, that's all. That dispatch which you mentioned that I received from Tirana today will not be the last. I expect more soon, not from Tirana.
Well, from the Italians say they've taken over all of the provinces. Where will your government be?
That, my dear Mr. Bockage, I would not tell you if I knew myself. Buildings do not make a government. Because it will be invisible, do not think that it will not exist. You can no more destroy my government than you can destroy the spirit of my people. We kept our independence for 2,000 years when nominal foreign states ruled over us, or thought they did.
I understand. It'll be like the Irish Parliament, I suppose, during the Revolution, before the Free State was formed. I understand then that you could address a letter to any member of the hidden Parliament, drop it in a mailbox, anywhere, and it would be delivered, but nobody knew the address. And sometimes I know the unseen is more potent than the seen. Mr. Minister, you told me that the news of the invasion first came to you like a bolt out of the blue. I think you used those words. Tell me a little about the relations between Albania and Italy before that.
They were the friendliest relations, political, economic, and cultural. Most of our students went to Italy to study. For 20 years, the Italian government has been telling its people that Albania was its good friend. Suddenly, it declared that we were an enemy.
Well, what about those loans that Italy made to Albania? Was there any trouble about the collections?
Let me tell you something about those loans. I have not any data here, of course, in detail, but they amounted to about 100 million gold francs, which is equivalent to $33 million. And that's... And that sum was not really a loan at all. It was a subsidy for Italian defense.
It looks a little more like Italian offense today, doesn't it?
Perhaps, and I will tell you why. It is true at first some of that money went into rehabilitating the country, but most of it was spent in strategic roads, and those roads were built for the purpose of war, and they weren't very useful to the Albanians. For these roads, those roads frequently deviated from the commercial centers.
Well, if Albania let Italy build these roads or built them with Italian money, didn't they expect Italy to use them?
You must remember we had an alliance of friendship with Italy. In that alliance, Italy and Albania agreed to help each other if a third power threatened it with war or declared war upon it. The roads were a part of our defense.
Most of them led right up to the borders of Yugoslavia and Greece, didn't they?
Yes, they do.
Didn't you expect that Italy might want to use them for offense as well as defense?
Well, certainly not in offense against us. By our alliance, we agreed to follow the fortunes of Italy if she were attacked or threatened with attack by another country. We did not agree to let her send her soldiers in our country or to take up our government. We fulfilled all our obligations under the treaty. If Italy had been attacked, we would have fought on her side. Presumably, that's what the roads were built for. But there was not the slightest excuse or reason for attacking us as if we were an enemy.
Do you think, Mr. Minister, that Italy intends to use those roads to attack Yugoslavia or Greece?
I doubt it very much. Italy does not fight countries which have organized armies.
Speaking of those roads, Mr. Minister, it reminds me that one of them, at least, has just served a purpose which no Albanian ever dreamed of. And from what I know of your countrymen, I imagine that not a foot of that road would have been built if they'd guessed what it was going to be used for. I'm speaking of the road over which your queen and her little baby made that unhappy journey when they fled from the capital to Greece.
Yes, a road that wound up over the high mountains and down southwest towards Greece. It must have been a terrible journey for that poor woman and the little child. They had to make a litter for her and put it in an automobile. That's the thing that perhaps enrages the Albanians as much as anything, that Mussolini should launch this drive on the very day that the king's son was born. In my country, family ties are very strong, and everybody acquainted with Albania knows that women and infants there are sacred and immune. That's why this brutality towards the queen and her baby is something that the simple people in the hills, as well as anyone who has any human sympathy, will never forget and never forgive.
I can understand.
You know, since this thing occurred, I have had to change my idea of the Italians, or at least of their government. I see now that those who criticized them were right, and I was wrong. Because behind all this tragedy, it seems to me, there is a touch of grotesqueness for a nation which wants to show its strength, to show it by attacking small nations. And the small nation in this case happened to be friendly. It is as if someone who you thought was a friend, who was always talking friendship with you, should suddenly stab you from behind.
I noticed that somewhere it was suggested that attacking Albania might make trouble for Mussolini with Mohammedan countries, of which he's supposed to be the protector. Do you think that's true?
Well, to strike down a nation where a very considerable part of the people are Muslims can hardly make a favorable impression on other Muslim nations.
Well, now, Mr. Minister, before we close, is there any message, any word you'd like to say to the American people?
No, I have no message. I do not want to dramatize the situation. It speaks for itself. I would like to thank you and the National Broadcasting Company for this chance to speak. There are many ties between Albania and America. We have never forgotten your Red Cross mission after the war and the equipment you left there, which was the beginning of our own Red Cross. Our queen is part American. The Albanian movement for independence was inspired by American ideals as well as by the memories of our past. It is the Albanian refugees in the United States who gave to that movement its strength. As your Secretary of State said today, the invasion of my country violates
the will of all the peoples of the world, the will for peace.
Thank you very much, Mr. Minister.